Our next speaker is going to be Janine Hansen, and I've asked her to address the topic, Learning What Issues to Address in the Campaign. And it's interesting, if you will study the voting record of your opponent, and you'll study the campaign donations received by your opponent, it's amazing what that will tell you, how they vote and who they've sold their souls to. And so Janine is going to address this now. Thank you.
I really appreciate being here with you because you are very special people. The Constitution Party people are the most wonderful people you'll ever meet. And so it's great to be here, and you've sacrificed to be here, and I appreciate that sacrifice from each one of you. And I am thankful for this opportunity. I have run for office every year since 2002. Every single election year since 2002. And the reason I've done that is because in 2002, my brother Danny, who many of you knew, who was the founder of our party, who had got us on the ballot. We got 17,000 signatures to get on the ballot with volunteers, and who had led our party all those years and sacrificed his life. He was killed in January, on the 22nd of January, and our state convention was a couple months later. But as a result of his dedication, he had written a few a pamphlet before that, inviting 50 candidates, that he said we needed to have 50 candidates. So as a result of his death, he was in a far better position to direct the party. And so as a result of that, we worked our hearts out, my brother Joel, my brother Chris, and I. And on the last day to file, we got four more candidates, and we had 50 candidates in Nevada to run for office. And that was an incredible experience. But we did duplicate it again, because a few years later we had 54 candidates. And this year we have 22 candidates. And why is that important? Because each one of those candidates is an ambassador for the party. They have their own constituency, their own strengths, their own opportunities. And even if they only do free things, interviews, they have many opportunities to spread the word. And then we're training them to do other things. Now, how many of you have been candidates? I want you to help me with my talk. How many of you have been candidates? Okay, now you're all qualified to be candidates. You know why? You're still breathing. Okay? So all of you and each one of you needs to consider being a candidate. That year we had 50 candidates. My mother was 86 years old. And it was my brother Chris's idea that she should run. And we never thought of her before. She's a very gregarious person. And so she ran for public administrator in Washoe County. And she had an absolute ball. She studied and learned everything that the public administrator does. She knew all about it. She was plenty smart. She went to all the candidates' nights. She talked to every person there because the thing she loved to do was talk. So she had a wonderful time, and she was a wonderful representative, and she got a third of all the votes in the county for that, and which was over 30,000 votes, which was very meaningful for our party. And so that's why I'm saying that the only qualification is that you still be breathing, okay? So you are. Now, what are some of the important things? Have any of you been, if not a candidate, a campaign manager? Have you ever done any opposition research, any of you that have been candidates? Okay, so those are all important. And part of opposition research is to find out about your candidate, your opponent. And some of the things you find out about your opponent is where they're getting their money. Now, how do you find that out? Do any of you know where you go in your state to find out where you find where your opponent's getting their money? Okay, in my state, we go to the Secretary of State's website because we have to fill out candidate expenditure and contributions reports. How many of you have those in your state? Do you even know if you do? Okay, if you don't know, you need to find out, because those are very important sources of information. Now, I oppose them. I opposed them in 1996 at the legislature when they put them in, and I still oppose them, and I'll tell you why. Because a few years ago when I ran for state Senate, I had all kinds of Republicans that wanted to support me. And I'd say, well, you know, I need a contribution. And they'd say, Well, I can only give you $100, Janine, otherwise I'll be up on the Secretary of State's website and the party will come after me. So these laws are used to suppress not only third parties, but they're used to suppress opposition that's not the anointed candidate in the Republican and Democrat parties. And when you go on the website and see what contributions your opponent is getting, you will find that it's the establishment. One of the things they do in my state is they have the whole list of all the lobbyists at the state legislature on their email list. And since I'm a lobbyist, I get those emails. And they send out every month to those emails, or so often, soliciting money all the time. And so when you go on the website, you can see what they do. Now, some of the people that are most interested in the money that your opponent is getting is who? Their opponent. They want to know if they can go and get money from the people that have given them money, because, you know, in case that other person wins, we want to make sure we've given them money too. You know about that. So these are important things. But one of the most important things to me is issues. I've spent my life working on issues, as probably all of you have. But if you're going to run for office, you need to know about the issues that have to do, as Daryl was talking about, with that particular race. Just as my mother studied what the issues were to be a candidate for public administrator, you have to know what the issues are in your race. If you're running for city council, you need to attend some city council meetings and know what the issues are in your community and participate there. And you need to be involved in that. If you're going to run for county commission, and some states it may have different names, but it's all the same point. If you're going to run for state legislature, you need to have attended the state legislature and you need to be involved in the critical issues of that. I'm going to tell you a story about this. I've run, I told you, every year since 2002, and I've never wanted to run a single one of them. I have to tell you that. But it's always been put on my heart that I needed to run. So several months ago, before our state convention, I felt that I needed to run for lieutenant governor. Now, I didn't want to run for lieutenant governor. Does the Lord require you to want to do what he asks you to do? No, you just have to be faithful and do it, and put your own agenda aside. So I knew I needed to do that. And the interesting thing was, is that the person, the main Republican opponent that I was going to have, was the Republican majority leader in the state legislature in 2015. And he oversaw the largest tax increase in Nevada history. The Republicans controlled both the assembly and both the Senate and the governors for the first time in 38 years. And what did they do? Just like all Republicans do. They betrayed us. And they passed the largest tax increase in Nevada history. And what was the second thing they did? We had the first time ever to be able to pass a parental notification on abortion. And we passed it in the assembly. And Dan's son, who is a Republican, led that fight and got it out of the assembly. And then they killed it in the state Senate. They killed parental notification, the most basic of rights for parents to know in trying to protect their daughters from the criminals that we have in our society. So I know about those because, why? I was there. I saw it happen. I testified on those bills. Now, today, the legislature is online. You can watch the meetings at the legislature in my state and most other states. I do a lot of work all around the country. I was just in Nebraska, and I've been here working at the Denver legislature. They have them online, and you can find out what the bills are online. You can find out what the committee hearings are. You can watch the committee hearings. In Nevada, if you don't live in Carson City, I have to move over to Carson City and live in a little apartment during the legislature. But if you live in Las Vegas, the most populated place, you can go in Las Vegas and actually testify via video conferencing. So you can participate in those whether you can go to Carson City or not. And who else is at the legislature? The lieutenant governor in our state is what? He's the president of the Senate. And of course, there are many other people. The attorney general has bills. The secretary of state has bills. And so you can become informed and involved. And you can be a credible candidate. So I was worried about running for lieutenant governor. I had run for Congress a couple times for Secretary of State. I ran for State Assembly. I ran a couple times for State Senate. I didn't have any problem running for those things, but I was a little nervous for some reason about running for lieutenant governor. And I thought, am I really going to be able to do this? And so they invited me. I went to file, and then the next day I went to a conservative talk lunch, and I spoke there. They're friends of mine, almost all Republicans. You need to make friends with those people. They vote. And so I was there, and so there was a person there that was the president of the Republican Men's Club in Reno. And he said, Janine, I'd like to invite you to participate in the lieutenant governor's debate at the Republican Men's Club. And I said, but I'm not a Republican. He said, that's okay, Janine, I want you to come. Now, why did that happen? I asked him later if he would invite our attorney general candidate or our treasurer candidate. He said, well, I made an exception for you, Janine. Everybody knows you. Everybody knows what you're doing at the legislature. So I'm not going to invite them. Why? Because I had done something in building at the legislature. I had paid the price. They knew I was there not to get money, but I was there to make a difference in what was happening. So I got to go to that debate, and I thought, oh my gosh, now I've got to get my campaign going. I haven't done anything about it. So the day before I left, and that was just a couple of days after I'd gotten home from Reno that time, and I live 300 miles from Reno, and I said, I've got to get my campaign stuff together. So I went through all my stuff from the legislature and the issues I knew, and I spent 6 hours that day writing essentially my platform. And I put it together, and I had my brother look at it, and I went over it. And the reason I knew these issues was why? I had been at the legislature. I had been sending out alerts to people. Now, you don't have to do as much as I do, but you can put your foot in. The best way to become a lobbyist, a citizen lobbyist, is to take your foot and put it through the front door of the legislature and start. And that's the best way to do it. And so I've been teaching people. I do citizen lobby workshops all around the state. Last year I did 7 around the state, Vegas, Pahrump, Washoe County, Winnemucca, Elko, teaching people how to be involved. And so I sat down and wrote this. And so as we began, we only had 1 minute to answer questions. And so, but I knew what my agenda was. So I wasn't going to just answer their question. If I had 30 seconds left, I was going to talk about something else that was on my agenda. And so when they all talked about the commerce tax, which needed to be repealed, which is the largest tax increase in Nevada history, I said, but did you know that now they have passed a constitutional amendment, which will be voted on next time again, and then by the people, which will triple your property taxes? None of the Republican opponents, and there were 3 there, none of them even knew about the property tax increase, anything that critical, and they didn't even know about it. And so as I proceeded to go with my issues, one of them was immigration and the fact that in the Nevada legislature, they had extended the driver's licenses for illegals from a 1-year renewal to a 4-year renewal. It allowed me to talk about the fact that $630 million in tax dollars every year were being used, Nevada tax dollars, to pay for illegals in our state. And there were many other issues, and I'll have this and you can have a copy of it. I put 6 issues on there. But the reason I knew about it is because I was involved in trying to make a difference. And so was I a credible candidate? When I went to the next debate down in Las Vegas at the Veterans in Politics, one of the fellows that had been there as a Republican candidate for lieutenant governor, he must have seen the results. And then they also put this debate on online, and they had over 10,000 people that watched it. So was that good for our party or what, huh? And so he said, well, Janine, you did very well because you knew the issues. And when I finished that debate, I said, oh, I can run for lieutenant governor. I know the issues better than any of them. And so I wasn't intimidated anymore. And I wasn't worried about it because I had done my homework. And I felt confident because I had put in the sweat equity to learn about these issues and to be able to communicate them, because they were on the top of my mind. I mean, I knew them as well as any issues. I could talk about almost any issue, the abortion issues that went on there. But these were the ones I chose for running for lieutenant governor at this particular time. So it's very important, as you choose these issues, to know what you're running for, to have been involved in that particular office in some ways, at least by observation, so that you are prepared and credible in your campaign. And that's not that hard, because frankly, they aren't very credible. and they don't want to talk about the issues. When you go to a candidate's night with Republicans and Democrats, what do they want to talk about? Oh, I have a very nice family, and I did this in the community. And you get up there with your 2 or 3 minutes, and you go, wham, 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 they're trying to triple our property taxes in the state of Nevada, and this is the issue, and why aren't they addressing it? And you put them on the spot. I always tell my Republican friends, you know, all the pressure for you goes on the left. And so we do you a great favor by putting the pressure on the right to go back to the Constitution and make you a lot better Republicans than you would otherwise be. So that's really the truth of it. And there isn't anybody in this room that isn't fully capable of being a candidate from one degree to another. You can all be candidates, and you can be ambassadors for our party. And you can look online and see how much money the other side's spending, and you can expose that because you'll know where to look, and you can talk about it. And the one candidate, of course, that voted for the largest tax increase in Nevada history, he didn't show up at the debate. You know, because why? He's got all the Republican establishment giving him the money he wants, so he doesn't need any of us. And that's an important issue we can bring up. Why isn't Senator Roberson here? Because he doesn't care about you. He's got the money from the big boys, and he can get elected with that. And you can even make that a very important issue for you in your race. And so we need to be informed if we're going to be candidates. Now, everybody isn't going to be running the same race. We have people all the way from state assembly and local county offices. We have somebody running for U.S. Senate, three candidates for Congress in Nevada. We have a candidate for lieutenant governor, candidate for governor, candidate for Attorney General, and a candidate for treasurer. But most of the rest of our candidates, because we need those to have a presence on the ballot to say, when you look at your ballot that says independent American, independent American, independent American, they say, oh, they're real. They have candidates. They do things. And that's very important. I remember the first time in Nevada, when we had the 50 candidates, and I looked at my ballot, and there were 13 independent Americans in my county on the ballot. Many of them were statewide. 13. And I could vote for everyone, and it was thrilling to be able to do that because I knew everyone was a good person. I told Daryl today, I said, oh, Daryl, when they talked to me about Trump, I said, well, you don't have to make excuses. I voted for Daryl Castle. You have to be the ones that make excuses now, not me. And so we can be proud of what we've done and what we can do. And as we become a presence on the ballot. Now, I talked earlier in the executive committee about how Adelson from Las Vegas, who is a multi-billionaire and owns the Las Vegas Review-Journal, the largest paper in Nevada, four years ago had tried to buy our party ballot line and buy our state chairman. He wanted this fellow to run for state chairman. And so we found out about it. He's a Republican operative. And we found out about it, and we made sure we had enough people at our meeting in order to stop that. But once you become a threat, once you become a possible vehicle, then at that point in time, people will be more interested in you. Now, we've already elected in the past probably 6 people to local office, local county offices, and that's a good place to start, running for local county office. But you may need to carry the banner for the entire party that you're involved in. Now, on the back of this, I've got a shortened version of my life as a taxpayer and an activist and some of the things I've done. So you need to think about what you've done to change your communities, to participate in a way that you can be a credible candidate and have something to say. When they asked me about being the lieutenant governor and running the Senate, I said, I've been there longer than any of them. I've been there every session since I was in college and full-time since 1991, so I don't think any of them know much more than me. No, I know how to do it. I've seen it. I've seen it year after year after year. So you don't have to be, and you don't have to have a pedigree like that. I don't want to put that burden on you. But what I'm saying is when you're involved in learning how to do it, you become a credible person. If you're out opposing that tax increase and you're carrying petitions to oppose it, and you're talking to the people, you can say, that's what I've done. I went out and invested my time and energy in getting this anti-tax ballot on the measure, on the ballot, or something else. And you can have an incredible opportunity to make a difference. And so as you decide on what issues you should discuss in your campaign, they need to be relevant to what you're running for. Okay? You don't want to talk about taxes if you're going to be the public administrator. But it would be appropriate if you were running for county assessor, which I've paired up my candidate that's running against the author, the sponsor of the property tax increase. I've paired her up with the Washoe County assessor that's fighting the property tax increase. He's a Republican, but he's coming to her events. Why? Because he wants to defeat that, and that woman is totally committed. She's totally committed to passing this property tax. Do you know how they did it? One night at the legislature, at 6 o'clock, they adjourned and said, well, we'll come back about 8 o'clock. I was exhausted. I'm working 16 hours a day at the legislature, and I just couldn't go back, so I watched it online. So they bring up this property tax bill and what it would do, and the figures from the Washoe County public assessor show that if you move out of your home and move into a new one, or somebody tries to buy a new one, what it's going to do, it's going to skyrocket your property taxes for your home and your business. What is this going to do? It's going to put our children will not be able to buy a home. It will take out of your paycheck money because the business owner has to pay property taxes. You probably won't get a raise because he has to meet his property taxes. There's many, many, many consequences of raising the property taxes. And the only thing it does is add more bureaucrats and more wasteful government in our state, and people are pretty angry about it. And then when you tell them that $630 million a year are going to support illegals in Nevada, this was a study that was done in Nevada, then they really get mad. So you don't need a lot of issues when you see them picking your pocket and that's what they're planning to do. And you can make a huge difference in that. So there are issues in any race you're running for that can make a difference. And you don't have to be an expert. Sometimes people ask me questions and I say, you know, I don't know. I can find out, but I don't know the answer. And you can do the same thing as you're learning. And so when you're plotting your campaign, I don't have a lot of money. I was trying to figure out what I was going to do for my campaign. So I said, well, I know I'm supposed to run, so I'm just going to have to do it. So I got my credit card and I drove to Reno, drove to Carson City to file. And I went to that meeting, and then I had to drive back the next week in order to be in the debate. And I thought, well, I'm racking up money, and I have to print this, and I have to print some cards. So I haven't raised any money yet. Janine, you've got to get busy and raise some money. And you've got to, because we all have to raise money. Now, you know why it's a great opportunity to raise money? You are taking all of your time to do this. You are defending the Constitution. You are bringing these issues forward. And that person there, they don't want to run for office. But you know what? You need to ask them and give them the opportunity to donate to you. Why? Because that's a blessing to them. It's a blessing to anybody that contributes to somebody that's really trying to make a change, isn't it? Don't you feel like when you give money to some cause that it's a blessing to you to be able to help them? Then quit worrying about them and worrying about yourself when you're going to raise money, and start thinking about the fact that you've dedicated your life to the cause, and do what you can and ask for the money. The only way you'll ever raise money is what? Three rules. Ask, ask, ask. Okay. So there's many ways to ask, and I do them all. So I hadn't asked anybody, and I'd spent almost $500 printing materials and doing this and doing that. And my husband had been out of work, and he'd just gotten a job, and we were, you know, I didn't have any money to spend on this. So I was worrying about it. So what do you do when you worry about it? Get on your knees, Janine, quit worrying about it, and quit whining, and start praying. And so I started praying about it, and I thought, well, you know, I'm just going to tell my story. I'm just going to tell my story about how I decided to run for lieutenant governor, and that what I'm going to do is use this as a soapbox, because when you run for office, people are interested in your opinion, aren't they? They don't care much about Janine's opinion when she's not running for office, but they do care when you're a candidate. And so I'm going to use this as a soapbox to defeat the property tax in Nevada. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to represent you because you can't do this and you're not willing to run around like a chicken like me. And so I'm going to do that for you. And so that's what I did. I wrote my story. And I sent it out to many of you about my story. And I was a little embarrassed to tell it because I was reluctant to run. And, you know, and I thought, oh, I've run so many times, people are going to think she's a perennial candidate, which I am. And all of these other things I was worrying about. And I said, Janine, quit worrying about it. You asked the Lord what to do. He told you to write this letter. You've written the letter. Now email it out, because I didn't have any money to send letters out because I didn't have any money for stamps. So that's what I did. I usually mail them out. And I do, who was it? Ricardo talking about databases? Yes, I keep databases. And so when I did that, and I just prayed about it, and so the first donations I got in were about two donations, and it was a total of about $70. And then the next few days, I was looking on my PayPal account, and you have to have a PayPal account. You've got to have a way for people to donate online. You have to set that up. You have to have a bank account. Those are things you have to do. That was part of the expense of the whole thing. And I was looking on there, and I look, and I thought, $500? Where did that come from? And I looked, and it was my doctor in Reno that I go to see, and I always talk politics with him. You know, we're always recruiting. So he loves what I do at the legislature. So he sent me $500, and the Lord answered my prayer. So I had the money I needed to pay the bill that was coming due, and I paid it. And so I, thanks, Lord. Thanks, thanks. And so then, just the day before I came, I came here on Tuesday because I had work to do with Eagle Forum as a volunteer. And I got two letters. Oh, and then, no, there was another. I got another donation from the National Constitution Party, someone that was on the list, for $100. So I thought, oh, I have some breathing room. And I'm going to do a gun show when I get home, and I needed to pay for the cost of the gun show and a few things. And then the next day, before I came here, I was looking, and I opened up my envelope. I had two envelopes, and one of them was for $25, and the other one was for $500. And I thought, oh, I told the Lord when I said I'd run for lieutenant governor, I said, you know, well, you'll just, because you're making me do this, you'll have to be my campaign manager. So he did a good job, didn't he? I thought he did a wonderful job. So if you're faithful and you do what you can have an incredible impact in carrying the banner of liberty across our nation. And you don't need the money from the big boys to make a difference. You can have an incredible opportunity to spread the gospel of liberty to everyone. And you know, I have 15 grandchildren, one of them born last week. And I'm running for them. I'm working for them and all of your children and all the children in America, because if we don't stand up as grandparents, what am I going to tell my grandchildren? Grandma didn't care. She wanted to be on Facebook. Grandma was doing doilies or some other ridiculous thing I would never do. I don't even know how. I appreciate people that do, but I don't know how. And so, you know, I don't want to give that excuse to my children and my grandchildren. I want them to know that Grandma cared enough to do as much as I could, like our founding fathers, to dedicate our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor to the sacred cause of liberty. And each one of you is engaged because you're here. And each one of you has a call to this responsibility. And they might not all be the same, but remember, you can all be candidates because you're still breathing. We never want to give up on that one. So thank you very much. And I'll leave this on the back so you can see my platform. And some of that money I spent, I can't find it now. Some of that money I spent, because I couldn't do a big nice brochure, was just on a little card. And on the back of that card, it had 4 points about my campaign, so that anybody I give that out to will have it. And I'll be able to do that. Now, one last thing I want to do. I know my time is up, and I'm going to hand these out to everybody. I'm a namiac. I collect names like a maniac, so I'm a namiac. You can all have a copy of this. This is the one I made up for my campaign. It has, so when I meet somebody, I say, oh, would you like to help me in my campaign? Here, fill this out. I never let an opportunity go by. These are always in my purse. And then on the back, it has a few things they will do. I've changed those with each race I've run for, but it always, I always give people an opportunity to contribute. Always. And maybe out of all the people I sent out, only 6 people sent me money, but it was every bit I needed and more. And so you can do the same thing. I'll put these on the back so that you can see them. Carry them with you everywhere. If you're recruiting, if you're running for office, I use them at the state legislature when I'm doing citizen lobby workshops, and I collect their names so that they can be on my email for my alerts I send out during the legislature. So you become a NAMIAC too, and God will honor your efforts in all that you do. And you know what? The Lord is so much more capable than we are that our own capabilities will be expanded beyond anything we ever dreamed that we could do with the help of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you.